بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين لمقدمه الفدا اللهم لعن قتلة أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام صلوات Respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. The night of the 19th of the holy month of Ramadan, although in a sense because it's one of the possible nights of Qad and the night of vigils and worshipping, and the night that inshallah we should expect to have our wishes, supplications granted, at the same time our hearts are grieved because we know that around this time in the year 40 after the migration of the Prophet would have been only few hours, 3-4 more hours before our dear Imam is innocently struck. If I had in mind tonight, in fact yesterday also I forgot to in less than a minute share with you one jurisprudential question and answer for the benefit of the gathering. But it crossed my mind something to bring it to the public attention this year, inshallah. Every year I'm telling myself, should I, shouldn't I? Don't be too picky on these issues. But for the sake of education, allow me to mention this. The holy ziyarat of Ziyarat al-Warith that we are reciting, I always see that the Jama'ah refer to it, and as in the PowerPoint also, it's written with the A at the end of it in English when they spell it. And people, they say Ziyarat al-Warith. Please remember, this is my humble contribution. Al-Warith in Arabic, you know, in Arabic we have feminine name and we have masculine name. Like Kateb means a male writer. Kateba, it means a female writer. Similarly, Warith, it means a male heir or inheritor. If you say Waritha, it means a female heir or inheritor. Ziyarat Warith, Warith is Imam Hussein alayhi salam. As-salamu alayhi ya Waritha Adama Safatullah to the rest of it. So Imam Hussein, because he is a male, is Warith, not Waritha. If you say Waritha, we are referring to Imam Hussein like as if you say she, which is grammatically incorrect. Of course, the intention is pure, inshallah, there is no problem with the intention, but it's good to also, when we are addressing the Imam or referring to that ziyarat, also say ziyarat al-warith. Now, one quick thing is that when you see in the ziyarat, say, As-salamu alayka ya waritha adama, and say waritha, there is, this is not the ta'al marbuta, it's fathah. And there is a grammatical explanation for that. That doesn't mean that we refer to Imam Hussein as Waritha or to this ziyarat as ziyarat Waritha. It is ziyarat al-Warith without A at the end. So humbly, if you may request the Jamaat in Dubai who have developed that program to update it and delete that A at the end with Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. From tomorrow night, we will be more talking about the special occasions, but because still, technically speaking, the atrocity has not taken place, allow me to continue with what we are talking about mystical ethics in comparison to normal ethics. The topic for tonight, inshallah, is going to be very useful, although naturally I have to make it short because we want to read majlis also at the end and relate to the occasion of the night. The topic for tonight is to get to know some of the characteristics of human psyche or human soul. First of all, it is important to know that, and as I have been talking and bringing this to your kind attention, and I hope I repeat it to the end of the month of Ramadan, until this is completely registered in our mind, more important, and trust my humble opinion, my humble experience, my mistakes in this field, that I don't wish you to repeat those mistakes. Believe me, knowledge in itself is not going to avail us. If not, often will be more causing us more troubles in dunya and in akhirah. Unless there is a good ground for our knowledge, the knowledge is not going to help. This is the main message I want to deliver. If you are buying or hiring a warehouse, Rumi says that, and I'm explaining it, I'm just bringing it to the version of 21st century, that if you want to hire a warehouse and have your stock there, especially if they are important stock, make sure first you go through the pest control procedure before you put your stock there. اول جان دفع شر موش کن وانگهی در جمع گندم کوش کن. He says, otherwise if you put your stock there and there is no pest control there, come tomorrow, you come to your warehouse and you see that everything is spoiled, everything is gone. That warehouse is our soul. He says, first we have to purify our souls before we put knowledge in it. Every Friday, it is recommended in our Friday prayer when we read Surah Al-Jumu'ah to recite this ayah, so that we also on a weekly basis hear this message from the Almighty God. أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Note that Quran says, first يُزَكِّيهِمْ, first purify your souls, first prepare the ground, and then put the knowledge, يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Before you teach your children the teachings of the Quran and Ahlul Bayt and Ahadith, first make sure that you purify, you prepare the ground for it. I have mentioned, and I like to repeat time and again, the main focus during the first 7 years of the life of our children, as well as the time of the primary school, during the period of the primary school, is to make sure that our children are grown with faith, disciplined with faith, with iman, disciplined with akhlaq. Knowledge can come later on. Jurisprudence, history, theology, you name it, can come later on. If there is a good concrete ground, you can build the sky rises as high as you want. But don't bombard children from very young age just by memorizing things, and we feel happy that, mashallah, my children see how much they know by heart. Don't get me wrong, not that this is not good, on the condition that the ground also is there, on the condition that the faith is there. Otherwise, come tomorrow, he's a teenager, the moment someone brings a misgiving to him, his like foundation of theology is shaken. Why? Because there is no concrete ground for it. Because there was no faith in the beginning, in early years of their life. It was only memorization, memorization, memorization. Not faith. So please remember, in a very unprecedented manner, in chapter 91 of the Holy Quran, Surah Ash-Shams, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we don't have an example like this anywhere else in the Quran, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes an oath twice, 3 times, 4 times, 10 times, no, 11 times, one after the other. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. والشمس وضحاها والقمر إذا تلاها والنهار إذا جلاها والليل إذا يغشاها. All the way until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قد أفلح من زكاها. Surely, undoubtedly, after 11 times of taking an oath, like someone says, Wallahi, Billahi, Tallahi, Kada, Kada. You say, okay, brother, talk, tell me what. 11 times, we don't have this anywhere else in the Quran, on any other issue in the Quran. suffices to show the significance of the issue of getting to know the nafs and purifying the nafs. Note, after all these times, Quran doesn't say, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ عَلَّمْ. Prosperous are those who are scholars. Prosperous are those who know the best and the most. No, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. Those who were able to purify their souls. And that's what we want to know about. What is the meaning of purification of the soul? صَلُّوا عَلَى مُحَمَّدْ وَعَلَى مُحَمَّدْ. Because it's the night of Amirul Mumineen Salamullah Alayhi, couple of gems of ahadith of Imam Ali Alayhi Salam, and Imam Ali has contributed a lot on this topic. Famous hadith from Imam Ali Alayhi Salam says, do you know out of all different sciences, all different knowledge, if you want me to tell you which one is most fundamental, most basic to start with, that you cannot do without, that is Ma'rifatun Nafs. أَنْفَعُ الْمَعَارِفِ. That's the hadith from Amirul Mumineen. مَعْرِفَةُ النَّفْسِ أَنْفَعُ الْمَعَارِفِ. Knowing your psyche, knowing your soul is the most beneficial knowledge for you, my friend. Remember in the previous nights I mentioned the dialogue between Abu Ali Sina, and that he was asking his contemporary scholar, calculate the area of walnut against a grain of barley. Don't get me wrong, I'm not against science, I'm not against jurisprudence, I'm not against theology, but priority is first to get to know myself. The reason that in our modern time, despite all the scientific discoveries and inventions, man is suffering because we have discovered the moon, we have discovered deep inside the oceans, everywhere else, but we have not discovered our souls. We have ignored ourselves and our souls. And that's why it's not going to help us. That's not why this is not going to give us any benefit. So what is the nafs that I need to know? And what is this purification of the nafs, tahzeebun nafs? In the terminology of the Quran, we have these 5-6 different terms used, all talking about one entity, one reality. Follow me. Nafs, ruh, aql, qalb, Sadr, Fuad. To the best, as I remember, these are the 6 names referred to one entity, to one reality. The point, in a nutshell, I'm trying to summarize the course in 20 minutes or so with you. In a nutshell, these are different names for one reality. It's just like you are a doctor. At the medical center, they call you doctor. You come here to the Imam Bargah, sitting among the Mu'mineen, Haji. You've been to Hajj, they call you Haji. Outside, somebody doesn't know you, you go Sumi and someone calls you Sir. You are the same person. But from different angles, they have different names and different way of addressing you. There is one entity, one reality, because of different functions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to it with different names. So when man was created, this body without that living thing that is referred to as ruh comes to it, it's just a piece of material like other materials in this dunya. When Quran says, وَنَفَخْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي, that entity, as far as is related to God, and as far as it is not going to perish, it is not mortal, doesn't die, doesn't sleep, because it's coming from God, it's going to God, and it's going to be eternally living, it's called ruh. Once it's connected to the body and is in charge of the body, human body, is called nafs. Why is it called nafs? Because nafs in Arabic language, when we are breathing, we say nafas. Maybe you are familiar with the term nafas. Nafas, yani breathing. A woman who is delivering, she is called nafas. Post-birth bleeding is called damen nafas because it's the bleeding of delivering. All right, nafas in Arabic also means blood. Why is it called blood? Because your breath is just like the, at least in the old physiology, that the breath is just like the blood that all around your body, all the vessels all around your body. For by the way, ruh, when it is connected to the body, and is given the charge, responsibility of the nourishment of the body, the growth of the body, is called nafs. The problem is with this nafs. It comes in charge. It's just like a very caring, compassionate father who wants to give the best to his children. Sometimes, because he wants to provide too much comfort, he closes his eyes in business because he wants to make sure his children don't suffer as he used to suffer, for example. He closes his eyes. Nafs, because becomes so much in charge and indulge in the affairs of the body, becomes so much giving and forgets that, look, I was here for a mission temporarily. This is not my place. I'm temporarily caged in body to let this body grow and flourish. Otherwise, I should not forget. I don't belong here. I'm like someone with a temporary visa. I don't have a citizenship. I'm not a permanent resident here. I have to return back. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Ignoring this fact gives too much attention to this. The result of this is that the other facets of my nafs, that is my ruh, becomes like shrinking until it may die completely. As for the kafir, that Quran says, "Summun bukmun umyun," his soul died because he ignored his soul, his ruh. I have to say it in Arabic, his ruh completely. Arafat, they have a very good metaphorical example for this situation to describe it to us well. Rumi has a book, a small thesis called Fihi Mafi, very interesting name he's given to that. The story also is mentioned it in Masnavi as well. He said once upon a time, you've heard maybe the story of Layla and Majnun. Like in the English literature, you have Romeo and Juliet. In the Arabic literature, we have Layla and Majnun. Majnun was the male who was the lover, and Layla was the beloved one. So Majnun wants to go to Layla's house. Now think in an Islamic way, they are engaged Islamically, and he wants to go see his fiancée. Back then, there was no Toyota, no Mercedes, so he's riding his camel. It's a she camel, naqe, in Arabic, she camel. It just happened that the she-camel had just given birth to her baby in the stable. But the rider, Majnun, wants the she-camel to take him to the house of Layla. So they start the journey, mounting on the camel and kicking the camel to go towards the house of the Layla. A little bit going forward, remember that I read the poem in Arabic, Hawa naqati khalfi wa qudami al-hawa. The mind and the interest and the intention and the desire of the she-camel is back to the stable where her baby is. The desire of the Majnun, the rider, is forward where the Layla is. So there is a dual inclination. The she-camel is inclining towards the stable. The rider is inclining towards the beloved one. It happens in this journey because, subhanAllah, the transports back then were much more advanced now. They could even fall asleep and automatically the vehicle goes. Very much advanced. Majnun falls asleep and the she camel, the naga, takes advantage as in reversing. Majnun wakes up. Oh, how come that we are still here? Kick her up and goes a little bit forward. It's the month of Ramadan and I'm going forward. Progress. After the Eid and after the month of Ramadan, life continues. Go back, Imam Bargah, quiet, lights off. It's just like you are asleep and your she-camel is regressing. That's the story of your life, my life, or Arafat. They say, my friend, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Next year, Ramadan comes, Muharram comes, forward. After that, backward, backward, forward, backward, forward. You know what happens? Majnun says that, come on, that cannot continue. I'm losing opportunities, I'm dying. And from the base, the boss, she's calling. This is 21st version. Boss keeps calling, what's happening? When are you going to come? I've been waiting for you. The Almighty God says, please, this is a metaphorical example. Take your mind to reality. Ya ayyatuha nafsul mutma'inna irji'i ila rabbika radiyatan mardiyya fadkhuli fi ibadi wadkhuli jannati. I've been waiting for you. Why don't you come? I don't know. Any time I fall asleep, my camel goes back. Finally, Majnun decides, he says, you know what? Enough is enough. You go to where you have come from, and I go to where I want to go. And he jumps off the she-camel and says that, I don't want this. Do you know which moment is that? That's the moment of death. That's the time that body and soul separate from each other. And the body will be buried, from where it has come from, the soil. And the soul will fly to where it has to go. Where? Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. The point is that Urafa, they say, you don't have to wait until you die. Mutu, says the Holy Prophet, qabla an tamutu. Before you naturally die, pretend that you are dead. How am I pretend? Like, remember that your soul has a... Tell your soul, and this takes me to the second characteristics of the soul with salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. This is about knowing the human psyche. One of the characteristics of this soul that caused me this trouble is that was so greedy. Quran in Surah Al-Ma'arij refers to that, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ خُلِقَ هَلُوعًا. Man is created unless he is trained, disciplined, otherwise he's created impatiently greedy. Impatiently greedy. So human psyche, human nafs is so greedy. Greedy for what? Wants to. The greed is the characteristics of hell brothers in negative sense of it. That Quran says that when on the day of judgment God is sending people of hell to hell and is asking hell, are you now satisfied? Are you full? Can we close the doors? And hell keeps saying, hal min mazid? Hal min mazid? Is there any more? Is there any more? This is the characteristics of nafs, that the more you give it, the more it's demanding. Please be with me, please, please. This is so important for those who really care about improving themselves and treating the nafs. Remember that there is a difference between the need of the nafs and the want of the nafs. Give it the need, but when it comes to the want, sorry, not can do. That's not for you. Otherwise, like any example you want to take it, come to the example of sleeping. The more you sleep, the more you want to sleep. The lazier you become. The more you feed it, the more you want to eat. Unless and until what we have this expression again, I borrow it from medicine. There is a disease among certain animals and in humans as well. DI, diabetes insipidus. is a chronic metabolism disorder that the animal, the human in that situation is demanding, desiring for excessive, like water, excessive food until it eats too much until it kills itself. Those with certain types of diabetes, when the blood sugar goes high, there will be the body, the brain is just like wants to commit suicide, killing the person, the patient, is demanding for more sugar, more sugar, more sugar. Doctors say, make sure there's no sugar around. Otherwise, he will be so curious, finding to eat as much as he can, doesn't realize that he's killing himself. Nafs is after killing us, killing our ruh, killing our religion, killing aql, qalb, and all the rest facets of this entity. You need to be careful. The treatment is that you tell him, only what you need. Some people, they say that women are, I don't know, some people, they say there's a common mistake. Let me clarify, take advantage of the opportunity. They say that, with all respect, ladies, I will correct myself. And unfortunately, it's the night of Amir al-Mu'mineen. I wish I have opportunity to analyze this ahadith properly. I don't want to bore you, really, because there's so much technicality involved in it. God forbid they attribute falsely to Amir al-Mu'mineen to have said that Imam Ali alayhi salam says that women are insufficient in intellect. And we took it for granted. First of all, this is not true. Inshallah, if opportunity comes in due course, I prove it to you. This is not the word of Imam Ali. This is in the Sunni books of Hadith and seeped into the Shia books, unfortunately. Anyway, if women are insufficient in intellect and they are more emotional, this is when you go to the shopping mall. This is when it comes to jewelries, when it comes to fashion parade and makeup, certain things that by and large, generally speaking, with all respect to mu'minat, that women are more desirous towards it. But men also in certain areas, believe me, if women are insufficient in knowledge, men sometimes are completely lose the intelligence. Completely they lose it altogether when it comes to the opposite sex. When a woman is seducing, I always tell the young guys, six packs, and tell them that show me how strong you are. When the semi-naked is crossing the road, let me see who is strong. How much does it take to lower your gaze? Do you see how tough it becomes? And you still call yourself intelligent? I'm more intelligent than my wife. So if you want to test the intelligence of a woman, test her when it comes to jewelry, makeup, certain things that we, usually it's a weak part of the ladies. You want to check the intelligence of a man, check him when it comes to the opposite sex. Why am I saying this? Because this is the characteristic of nafs for the female and for the male as well, each to their own. We have to put a bridle, this is about ma'rifat or nafs, and tell your nafs, look, my friend, you need certain this hour of sleeping. Medically, scientifically, it's proven that that's how much you need. More than that, not can do. You need that much food. More than that, not can do. You need, when it comes to halal, everything. Otherwise, if we unleash it, remember diabetes insipidus. If we unleash it, it's going to but kill us without any question, killing our soul. This is the second. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. The third characteristics of human psyche or soul that is so important for us to know how to deal with it, is that human nafs is the most hypocritical flatterer. Don't be fooled. Should I say this? Should I confess sitting in the member of Imam Hussein alayhi salam and telling you this? If I have to speak about myself, I'm just typically speaking, saying this. And honestly, it is by and large true. If I want to talk about my virtues and my credentials and praising myself for the rest of the night, for the rest of the month, for the rest of the year, still I can talk. Each and every one of us are like this. When it comes to giving the benefit of the doubt, I give the benefit of the doubt. I become intelligent, so genius when it comes to justifying something that I've done to make sure there is a good justification for it. But when it comes to the actions of others, to the speech of the others, mashallah, nitpicking. So intelligent to pick on their mistakes. When it comes to myself, as if there is no mistakes. Practically, we live such a life that as if I'm infallible and others are all sinful people. Is it not? Let us think about it. Al-insanu ala nafsihi basira walau alqa ma'adhira. We know that ourselves. You know why? Because of nafs. It's the trick of our nafs. Our nafs is so hypocritical. Our nafs is so flatterer. Keeps flattering you. No, mashallah, you're doing quite a good job. On the way back home tonight, mashallah, good on you. What a good lecture, Sheikh, you gave. Thumbs up. Oh, mashallah, how nice you recited. And on the top of that, already I'm having problem with myself. On the top of that, somebody comes and tap on my shoulder. My friend, my nafs already has killed me. You don't need to slaughter me anymore. This is the characteristics of human nafs, human psyche that is flattering. Quran mentions in Surah Yusuf, quoted from Prophet Yaqub, قَالَ بَلْ سَوَّلَتْ لَكُمْ أَنفُسُكُمْ أَمْرًا فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ سَوَّلَ تَسْوِيلٌ. It means this is the trick of the nafs, who is the agent of shaitan inside me, subhanallah, an enemy within, that says that, look, don't worry, I will make it such a beautiful package. So glittering, you know, some businesses, they always say that packaging is more important than what is inside. Because people usually, they judge the books by the cover. Make a very nice package. Inside is the rotten stuff, things, but beautiful packaging, and says, mashallah, this is what you have done. Amir al-Mu'mineen, to counterattack that, this is ma'rifat al-nafs. Knowing the trick of my nafs, Amir al-Mu'mineen says, a mu'min, a pious person, is nafsuhu indahu dhanun. He is always giving the benefit of the doubt to others. When it comes to himself, he's so critical, nitpicking about himself. Somebody stood up in front of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, such a noble person, nafs of the Prophet, praising Imam Ali alayhi salam in front of everybody. Look at the answer of Imam. When he finished, Imam raised his hand and said, Ya Allah, forgive me for what he doesn't know about me. And make me better than what he doesn't know. Do you see? This is a real, that's why we say Imam Ali is Imamul Muttaqeen, Amirul Mu'mineen. This is the leader. This is a true believer. Imam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. I think it's enough for now. I don't have more time. Let's digest on it, please. Please remember, we need to spend time to get to know our nafs and the tricks of our nafs, not to be fooled and deceived by it. Let me take you now to the city of Kufa. In a night like tonight, at Maghrib time, a little bit further back, the last Ramadan of the life of Imam Ali alayhi salam. Imam Ali every night for iftar was invited at different places of his children. Tonight, the night of 19th of Ramadan, happened to be invited in the house of Sayyidah Zainab salamullah alayha for iftar salamullah alayha. Sayyidah Zainab is the narrator. She says, my dad was over for iftar. Always the food of Imam Ali was very simple. Especially tonight, he only had 2-3 morsels. I said, dad, you've been fasting. Why don't you eat? Look at the answer. Imam says, Ya'atini amrullah wa ana khamis. The promised day is approaching. I want my stomach to be empty. I don't want to meet God with a full stomach. Get the message of knowing the nafs, not to feed it too much. Sayyidah Zainab says, I said, dad, what are you talking about? Imam wasn't explicit. Amirul Mu'minin says, my dear daughter, after the battle of Uhud, your grandfather promised me this coming day, gave me the signs for my martyrdom, and told me the time will come in a month of Ramadan that my beard will be mixed with my blood. All the signs that the Prophet had said have come through, especially a few nights ago, I saw your grandfather in my dream. You know the civil wars they impose on Amir al-Mu'mineen. Imam Ali says, in my dream, I confided with the Holy Prophet. And I complained to the Holy Prophet, said, Ya Rasulallah, you know how your community treated me after your demise. The Prophet says, Ya Ali, pray against them. And in my dream, I said, Ya Allah, take me away from them and give them the one that they deserve. And the Prophet says, Ya Ali, only few more nights and you will be my guest. That was the last sign the Prophet had given me after the Battle of Uhud. So I know that it's one or two more nights only left. All the signs have come. Now you imagine Zainab salamullah alayha, how she feels. After losing her mother, after losing her grandfather, now this is the time that she's hearing about the loss of her father. She narrates, she said, tonight, after the iftar, after praying, my father did not sleep tonight at all. In the yard of the house, backyard, forward, front, he is walking back and forth, and all the time he's looking at the sky, and he says that the promised time is approaching. The promised time is approaching. Until at dawn time, Imam Hassan and I, we went to my dad. Dad, I don't feel comfortable. I feel something is happening. Tonight you are not normal, father. Is it possible? Because they knew about all the atrocities, all what the rebels were doing against Imam Ali. Is it possible? Perhaps tonight don't go for namaz sob. Send someone to lead the Fajr prayer. Initially, Imam Ali accepted and soon he changed his mind. And he just shouted, reciting this verse to himself, Ushtud hayazi mak. فَإِنَّ الْمَوْتَ لَاقِيكَ وَلَا تَجْزَعْ مِنَ الْمَوْتِي إِذَا حَلَّ بِوَادِيكَ. در بیت خدا شیر خدا را کشتن داماد نبی امام ما را کشتن. Imam talks to himself and he says, Ali, fasten your belt, get ready. The angel of death is coming down. This is a definite destiny, you cannot avoid it. Imam Ali alayhi salam says, no, my dear, I have to go lead the prayer myself. As he is trying to leave the house, Allahu Akbar, Bibi Zainab, she had some dogs in her house. These animals, by their instinct, they came and blocked the path of Imam Ali alayhi salam and flapping in front of of the Imam. Zainab wants to remove them. Imam Ali alayhi salam says, "Da'uhunna fa'innahunna nawa'ih." My dear daughter, these bears are not flappy singing. They are mourning. They are crying. They are telling me, "Ya Ali, kill us. Ya Ali, sacrifice us. Our dear, Ya Amir al-Mu'minin, please don't go out tonight." And Imam Ali alayhi salam is crossing them, getting to the door. Subhanallah, the narrators, they say even the door was jammed. The remover of the gate of Khaybar removes the gate of the house of Zainab and makes his way. He goes into the masjid. Allahu Akbar. That Mal'un, Ibn Muljam al-Mal'un, he's lying on his chest to hide his sword. Imam passes by him and kicks him with his foot and he says, "Don't sleep like munafiq, like a hypocrite," like passing a message to him. Goes to the minare and calls for the adhan himself. Narrators vary about the time that Imam was struck. I rely on a hadith from Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam, who was already born and was living in Kufa with his father Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam says, "My grandfather Amirul Mu'minin was struck while he was in the sajda of the Fajr prayer." So we continue with that narration. Amir al-Mu'minin stands to pray. Ibn Muljam Mal'un stands right behind Imam Ali alayhi salam. Ruku, and when the Imam goes to the sajda, everyone follows the Imam. And this Mal'un is still sitting up, raises his sword, and it's so hard he's struck in the head of Amir al-Mu'minin. As soon as the head was split and the blood was gushing out, Amir al-Mu'minin cried out, "Bismillah wa billah wa ala millati rasulillah fustu wa rabbil ka'bah." Ali is prosperous now. Never before that Ali says, "Oh, I'm prosperous." Now Ali has achieved what he wanted to achieve, martyrdom in his life. Ala la'natullah ala al-qawm al-zalimin. وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّامٌ غَلَبٍ يَنْغَلِبُونَ. صلوات ما تعلم شو يا حسين